وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعه وله وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد, we continue with the sessions of Seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam وسلم, reflecting on it, learning from it, relating to it, taking lessons from it that benefit us in our lives. Last time we talked about the arrival of Rasulullah sallallahu to Medina and the lessons that we learned from that journey, that trip, lessons learned from the planning of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, being careful, carefulness of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the planning, proper planning and the proper execution, and trust of certain people. We also learn from the suhbah of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the sacrifice, the ultimate love and friendship. When you believe in someone, you prefer them over yourself. And when that happens, how Sayyidina Abu Bakr, as the head of the family, resulted, and his relationship to Rasulullah resulted in the whole family being in the service of the deen of Allah. Yes? So when the leader of the family or the head of the household really knows what is required from him or from her, the whole family is affected. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, you see his daughters, Asma, and his son, and his servant, the freed slave, Amr ibn Fuhayra, Abdullah ibn Abu Bakr. All of them, they were in the service of the Hijr. And then we learn also along the way that the travel or the trip, it is not only about the goal or the destination. It is the experience itself. The journey also have lessons to learn from. So that's why we were in the Hajj. The brothers and the sisters who go to Hajj, they are always focused about what they are about to do. They arrive at Jeddah airport, they want to reach Mecca for Umrah, which is understood. But from Jeddah to Mecca, you're going to be waiting for a bus, riding a bus, being in the company of the people, eating and drinking and spending a couple of hours until you reach Mecca. What's your plan in this? Huh? You leave your home, ride your car, want to come to the masjid. But what's your plan in the road? Do you have a wird or a routine to do the tasbih or dhikr? If you come Maghrib every night, it takes you 10-15 minutes to come and 10-15 minutes to reach home. What do you do in that time? If you only focus on the destination, then this is going to be like a time of your life that has no, it's blank, like, you know, cloudy. So, 15 minutes times 7 times, 30 minutes a day, or maybe 1 hour a day commuting, okay, times 7, that's 7 hours per week, times 4, that's 28 hours, 28 hours per month, times 12, you can make the math, yeah. Okay, so how many of those days, they are days, every month, there is one day, minimum 24 hours at least, that you don't know what you are doing in it. You could have done a lot, right? So it's like one day every month, it is trashed. Every single month there is one day. So every year there are 12 days. So now if you live 50 years, you see how many months they were done that you could have said, in all my life, there was about a year that I was doing astaghfirullah, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, that was only in the commuting time. So here is the trip and the journey of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Mecca to Medina. There are incidents happening in it, and we cover those. Somebody accept Islam, they're making da'wah, they going to the tent of Ma'bad, the barakah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's affecting, he's he's being Rasulullah while he's traveling, while he's sleeping, while he's waking, while he's talking, while he's walking, you know, every. So how about us? Being a good Muslim. When you are in the masjid, there is a session like this, you are being a good student. After that session, you become a good teacher to teach it. When you're driving, you become a good driver, a good Muslim, a good American, a good human being, a good whoever, or whatever, whenever needed. So we learned that also from the Hijra of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. But when he arrived in Medina, they did not say, oh, jet lag, I need to wait for a couple of weeks until, you know, I figure my things out and I rest. Huh? Did this happen like that? No. The work starts from the moment he arrived, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Building Masjid Quba and all of that. But when he reached to where the Masjid al-Nabawi is right now, he said, هذا المنزل, inshallah. This is where we are going to be building the Masjid. And that's the first pillar of the Muslim community in Medina, was building the Masjid. So when Rasulullah entered Medina, he started at once establishing the foundation and the pillars of the new state of Al-Islam on very strong foundation and very profound pillars. Building the Masjid was one of the pillars once Rasulullah arrived. Brotherhood between Muhajirin and Ansar was also one of the pillars, teaching the Quran and the tradition. Rasulullah teaching them and showing them that they are part of this universe, part of this world, part of this state. And Rasulullah also established the economy of the politics, the economy, the relationship with the people outside. So from the minute he arrived, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all of this was his attention, you know, was figuring out all this. It's not like someone who is going there to lead the salah. There's a mushkila we have now when we look at the masjid as a service center. We don't look to the masjid as a pillar of the community. So the larger community, part of it is this. It is not a service center that you come, like you go to work to as a job, you are home to sleep, and you are at the masjid to pray, and that's it. Well, this is not a good configuration. Yani. That's not a good configuration. This is a pillar of your life as an individual and a pillar of the community. This is where the community come to when they want the proper information. This is where the community comes to whenever there is a rumor that they want to come and authenticate and see what is the truth, not the other way around. You come to the masjid, then there are issues. We come to the masjid and this is where rumors start. You come to the masjid where everybody can say whatever. No. Masjid is to solve all of this. So masjid is a pillar of the community. Brotherhood is a pillar of the community. A financial system for the Muslims is the pillar of the community. Okay? Problem resolution or conflict resolution is a pillar of that community. We have to have a criteria system. Me as a Muslim, whenever I have an issue, I should come to the masjid. Should come where? To the masjid. Not come to the masjid to find problems. I come for the masjid for solving the problem. I hope that's clear, yeah, right? That's why the first thing Rasulullah did when he arrived, he's establishing a community. Doing what? Building a masjid. So that is in the head here. It is not like, oh, we figured everything, let's build a $1 million masjid now, because we need this. We start, you know, looking at the masjid in that way, then the masjid is never serving its purpose. Look around you. Look. This around us here is a result of why we build the masjid. You got what you actually wanted. So please don't ask and complain and cry why the masajid are empty. If when we're building the masjid, it is really for the family, We are not going to be complaining that the kids are running and screaming and all of that, because while we are building the masjid, we will have a good center for babysitting, for the children, for the moms, for the dads, for everybody. If really we care about the youth as a strong segment of the community, as actually the backbone of the community, the blood of the community that flows in the arteries of the community, then when the masjid is built, the youth are building it, the youth are managing the activities, the youth are there, the youth are part and parcel of it. So we will not be crying about why the youth are not coming to the masjid, because they were there before the masjid. Which one comes first, the chicken or the egg, huh? The youth and the children first, or the building first? Normally the youth and the children first. People come first. People live and buy houses first. Then the masjid comes after that, yes? So when the masjid comes after that, with everybody in mind, with the need of the Muslim community and the masjid as a pillar of the Muslim community, then from day one, the masjid will be serving every single activity for the community, and community grows, the masjid grows. No problem of having 5-6 locations, no big deal, this is not the issue. Actually, this should be a good sign, should be a good sign that a masjid grows until it reaches a level that it cannot grow anymore. But people keep growing, so we have satellite locations. And then you have the Masjid al-Jami', which gathers everybody. Yeah, why not? That's what was the case at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I hope you got the idea. Yeah. Now, that's a very important topic. This masjid is a very important. Masjid is not a building. Masjid is here. Masjid is here. Masjid is in my life. Okay, masjid is in the heart. Masjid is in the mind. So wherever you are, you're looking for the masjid. You're looking for what? Masjid. You know, في مذهب الحنابلة, in the madhab of Ahmed ibn Hanbal, there is something very nice about the masjid. To appreciate the different madhab in fiqh. You know, in, those who have madhab Ahmed ibn Hanbal, like myself, whenever you go to any town, you look for the oldest masjid in it and pray to rak'ah in it. عارفين ليه? Why? You know, this is one opinion in the madhab. You know, they said, اذهب إلى المسجد العتيق. كان أنس رضي الله عنه يفعل ذلك. أنس بن مالك, he used to do that. Whenever he goes to a town, he said, دلوني على المسجد العتيق. يعني, show me the oldest masjid in town, so I pray. Why? Because it aged with people praying in it. Means the history of people praying in it is longer than any other masjid. See, understanding the concept of what? Of the masjid. What does the masjid do? It is not only to fulfill my need to pray now. No, I am going to that masjid. I want to be part of it. And I want to be someone who prayed in it, like those who have been praying for hundreds of years. And the older it is, the better for me. Now you understand, right? So whenever you travel to a country or to a city next time, try to see where the oldest masjid of it, and go pray to rak'ah. Because oldest masjid in it, معناها في ناس كتير أو صلوا فيه. If it is 100 years old, means 100 years, there was ibadah established at this masjid. So I want to be part of this. I want to put my signature there. It is like those people who want to put their name in a historical location or something. It's just like that. But this comes from what? Understanding what the masjid do. So when you go to Masjid al-Nabawi, yes, because Rasulullah ﷺ is there, but that's where it all started. And he wanted to sign there. He wanted to be there. He wanted to get that charge there. So when we come back to our masajid, we want to have that understanding. Also, Rasul ﷺ, when he chose the land, he found that this land belongs to two orphans. And those two orphans were gaining money from that land by people, from people who come and dry the dates in it. You know, the dates, which is come from the tree, they put it to dry. Some dates, they dry it. So they put it in the sun, a flat land, nice area, clean. So people there go and put their dates in it. So that's how the owner of this land, those two orphans, gain income. And it has also other things, but that land is owned by them. So Rasulullah ﷺ said, we'll do here, and I'm going to purchase that land. He said, yeah, la, ya Rasulullah, we'll give it as a gift. He said, no, I pay. And the lesson here, very important for us as Muslim communities. Sometimes, you as a Muslim need to donate, need to participate. Don't say someone is able to pay 100,000. No, your dollar is also important. Okay? Your dollar is also important. Somebody can gift that land. No, but we want to pay and we want to do. And I want to put my effort in it. That's another lesson also. The Rasul ﷺ showed them that he works by himself. Also, carrying the rocks and carrying the stone and carrying the labin, tubi, and building with them, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, by example, teaching by example. Even you do one or two, that's the sunnah. You have to do. And that's what made the Sahaba say, if we sit here and they leave Rasulullah working, so what good are we? How good are we? We have to. So sometimes these touches, these little things, very important. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam purchased that. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam worked by himself, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Also Rasulullah chose to build the houses of his wives very humble. As I told you last time, a person can touch the ceiling with his hand. An average person, yani a person who's 5'6", 5'8", can put his hand like this and it touches the ceiling comfortably of that. Houses of Rasulullah and never ever think that this was because of poverty. Means he did not have money to build. But can you only say, and the people, they had palaces in Medina with balconies and backyard and front yard and palm trees, and they had that at that time. So it was able, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to say, yeah, one of those houses. They will give willingly with love. They will build the biggest one to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, no, this is how it is. Masjid also, he made it humbly, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Listen for us, right? He can do it, but he chose not to do it. Nothing wrong in doing something fancy, but you understand that Rasulullah chose to do humble. Also, al-adhan. Al-adhan is shi'arul Islam. It is the sign of life of Muslim. When you make the adhan, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, that's a statement. Allah is greater than me, greater than powers, greater than money, greater than health, greater than everybody. 5 times every day you hear this. Every salah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Sami'a Allahu Hamid, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Come on now. It should mix with every cell in your body now, right? That Allah is Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Twice. Shahada. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Amal. Sunnah. So al-aqidah. And my life is according to this. Hayya ala al-salah. Here is the example. Come for the salah. Hayya ala al-falah. That is the success. Then Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. See, and then if you think about it, is a great pillar of the community too. Great important foundation. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave a khutbah in his masjid. First khutbah at his masjid was very short. You'll be amazed. The khutbahs of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was 2-3 minutes. You'll be surprised. But the salah was long. Okay? So because khutbah was a reminder. Because there was teaching every day, every hour, every salah. So why give a long khutbah? You know why we give long khutbah? Because people don't show up except in the khutbah time. So we want them to listen to 20 minutes, 30 minutes. Because we have no choice. But if people attend these kind of sessions every night, khutbah should be 5 minutes. Wallahi, more than enough. More than enough. Listen. Listen to the khutbah of Rasulullah and you will understand what I'm saying. And put a stopwatch. After he said Alhamdulillah salatu was salam on himself sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said Amma ba'du ayyuhal nas qaddimu li anfusikum. O people, do for tomorrow, work for tomorrow. تعلمن والله لا يصعقن أحدكم one of you will die any time ثم لا يدعن غنمه ليس لها راع is referring to family as well right that means all those under responsibility suddenly will not have any ثم لا يقولن لربه وليس له ترجمان then he will talk to his lord directly to Allah directly nobody in the middle and no حاجب no guard on the doors of Allah Azza wa Jalla to allow you to enter or not but you will find yourself standing in front of Allah and he will tell him Allah will tell say to one of you alam ya'tika rasuli fabalagtuk didn't my messenger come to you and he delivered wa ataytuka malan and I give you money wa afdaltu alayk and I give you more bounties fama qaddamta li nafsik what did you give to yourself what did you prepare for today فَلَا يَنْظُرَنَّ يَمِينًا وَشَمَالًا The person, one of you will be looking left and right فَلَا يَرَى شَيْئًا Means no عمل, no deeds ثُمَّ لَيَنْظُرَنَّ قُدَّامَهُ He will look in front of him فَلَا يَرَى غَيْرَ جَهَنَّمْ We'll see only جهنم فَمَنْ إِسْتَطَاعَ أَنْ يَقِيَ وَجَهُهُ مِنَ النَّارِ وَلَوْ بِشِقِّ تَمْرَةٍ فَلْيَفْعَلْ Whoever can save his face from that hellfire even with giving half date in sadaqah should do so وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ Whoever does not find even that فَبِكَلِمَةٍ طَيِّبَةٍ With good word فَإِنَّ بِهَا With that good word تُجْزَ الْحَسَنَةُ عَشْرُ أَمْثَالِهَا إِلَى 700 ضعف You'll get a good deed multiplied to 10 and the 700 وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ That's a khudwa See I even translated يعني Right? So half of that time is the actual khudwa 5-6 lines 2 minutes And then he rest, then stand up and make the dua. خلاص, أقم الصلاة. Salah might be 15-20 minutes. Because standing in front of Allah and doing salah. That's what Jum'ah of Rasulullah is. Khutbah al-Wada', the most important khutbah in Islam, the farewell khutbah, when you read it, it does not take more than 5 minutes. Doesn't. Actually, it can be less. لو قريت خطبه الوداع, it is one page. One page, letter size, you know, 15 by 18, whatever they call it, and or 11 by 15, this letter, yeah, the size of letter in the document, that fits in one page easily. That's the khutbah al-wada'. They are not this deen is not about talks and speeches. This deen is about reminders and action. Teach you the values and remind you of them all the time, constantly. And work more, work. That's what it is. When we talk too much, that means that there is less amal in the community. Trust me, I know. Yani. I'm not happy whenever there is a lecture after lecture after lecture. I teach in the same spot 3-4 hours every week of talk. Unless this is translated to 15-20 hours of work in the same masjid, in the same community, means no value. معلش يا اخوانا سامحوني يعني I'm very offensive sometimes like this forgive me but if you have the tally of the lecture giving at a masjid at the end of the week there are 10 hours of lectures this speaker and that speaker this brother and this sister talking like this kind of lecture they have to multiply by 5 times of hours of work in front of them so should do that statistic maybe you know how many speeches lectures how many engaging programs means back and forth and how many projects done in the community this is how we measure ourselves when you read in the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam how many times you find him speaking and how many times you are seeing actions very little speech Then there was in the building of the masjid, as-suffah. Suffah is like a higher area, like if this is the masjid, in the back of the masjid, there is that area that people rest in it who do not have any houses, or who are coming as guests, they sit there temporarily, or somebody who's poor, or somebody there to seek knowledge. Sometimes they have houses in Medina, but they come there and sit there and sleep there, like i'tikaf, to listen from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or like Abu Huraira, It's a mistake when you think that Abu Huraira was poor from the beginning. No. Abu Huraira, when he came with his family, his mother and his brother and all that, he had a servant that's serving him, Abu Huraira. But he became poor because he spent everything. And he did not have a job or anything like that to gain more income. Why? Because by choice. By choice. He wanted to compensate for the time that he did not spend with Rasulullah like the Muhajirin and Ansar. So he came the last 3 years of the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he gained more than any one of them who are with Rasulullah from Mecca time. And he mentioned that. He said later, he said, some of you accuse me that I say too much. How come I say too much while I stayed with Rasulullah too little? There was an accusation for him. Abu Huraira hadith kathir, and he talks. He said, by Allah, this tongue does not say except the truth. I dedicated my life to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to listen from him. And the only thing is just looking for a meal to survive. Meal to survive, and I don't want anything else. Just sitting there waiting for a meal to come from indillah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But my life was to listen from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And my brothers of Al-Ansar, they were busy with their lives. Muhajirin Al-Ansar, they go work, come back, work and come back. And people of Al-Ansar, they have houses and house and the families, and they go and come back. But I was sitting with Rasulullah all the time, 24/7. So Suffa was the people like that. Some of them, they migrated. They don't have families. And when their family arrived to Medina, they establish house and everything. They leave Suffa. Some of the people of Suffa, Mujahideen, they go with Rasulullah Jihad, they die, Shaheed. So Ahl Suffa were not like people who settle there and they don't go. La, they were involved in the community, but they preferred to sit with Rasulullah in the masjid to learn firsthand. And they were poor. And Abu Huraira was like the supervisor of Ahlul Suf. That's why whenever Rasulullah has food, he said to Abu Huraira, invite Ahlul Suf. And whenever he gets money, or the zakah money, or the sadaqah money from someone, he gives priority to Ahlul Suf. His daughter Fatima radiallahu anha, one time she asked Rasulullah for a servant. He said, you have slaves and all that, bring me someone to. He said, I will not give you while Ahlul Suffa can benefit. So I sell in the market and I give them the money. So that's what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to do with Ahl al-Suffa. Taban, I'll tell you something interesting here. Suffa, it was built when the masjid was built. And it was at the end of the masjid. Yani the Qibla, Suffa was the opposite. But what direction they were praying in the beginning for 16 months? Toward what? Masjid al-Aqsa. Right? So when the Qibla changed, the Suffa position became opposite. صح? So they changed to the opposite side, which was the original Qibla. That's why people, when they go to Hajj, said, Sheikh, we want to go to Masjid al-Qiblatain. Masjid al-Qiblatain, right? I said, what is the special thing about Masjid al-Qiblatain? That people pray to both toward both Qibla, Masjid of the Prophet also, same thing. Masjid Quba was same thing. Every Masjid was in Medina. They did the same thing. But sometimes we get stuck with that certain historical thing. Yani Masjid al-Qiblatain is a historical issue. Has no religious significance in it, except it's the house of Allah. Yes? Yani Masjid Quba has a religious significance. Yani you do wudu and you go to the Masjid Quba and pray, it is like the reward of Umrah. So it has a religious significance, Masjid Quba. But Masjid al-Qiblatain, and the people prayed the same prayer toward the two Qibla. So what? Maybe the same thing happened in the Masjid of the Prophet. We don't have any proof against it. So Masjid of the Prophet also, he prayed 16 months toward this and then changed 180 degrees. Because the Qibla is a complete opposite, right? If Medina is here, Bayt al-Maqdis is up toward the northwest, a little bit, toward the northwest. And the Kaaba is south. south toward the east a little bit. So it is like you praying this and then you change praying this. So 180 degrees is straight. Okay? So Sufa was in the back and it's still in the back with that change in mind. And Ahlul Sufa used to go up and down. Some narration says there are 70, which is a decent number. Sometimes they reach 80. And some Sahaba used to host all of them, like Ubadah ibn Samit, he used to teach them how to read and write and teach them Quran. Right? Those, because Sufa, the people come, people leave, they are not stable, yani. They are not the same people all the time. And it's very important to know that, because some people say, oh, I will leave the masjid forever. No. These people were transient, yani. They come, they go based on need. It's not like they decide, like, you know, I'm going to be there. Abu Huraira himself, after Rasulullah ﷺ, he started going on and about. And he was even the Amir of Al-Bahrain. You know what's known as Bahrain now? He was the Amir of that at the time of Sayyidina Umar. Living in a big house and all that. Abu Huraira, yani. So Abu Huraira is not like poor by nature, you know, by choice. Like he have no choice. He's a poor man. He doesn't want to work and he's staying there. No, it's not like that. He was like someone coming to study, doing a PhD. So during that PhD, he's living a certain life, focused. And then after that, he goes and teaches in the university and dress properly, and well, no problem. So Abu Huraira was like that, radiallahu anhu. I want you to understand about the Sahaba like this. Okay? Now. Also, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever somebody comes, he tell him, okay, you can stay with Ahlul Sufa. And 2-3 days he find him, someone said, you know, take him, teach him something or have a business for him or something like that, managing the affairs of the people. Subhanallah, where are we from that now? When a Muslim loses a job or trying to find a job, huh? Or having a business or hiring or something like that, priority should be given to the community. I told you, masjid is pillar of the community. Masjid is not a service center, ya khwan. Service center, everybody will be looking what they get from the masjid. It's not like that. We need this masjid as a community to serve our needs. And when we think about like that, then you'll find the masjid always initiating activities, having activities, giving to the community and taking from the community and giving back to the community like that. So it's an institution. We say marriage is an institution, but people think marriage is man, woman, house, and then children. Think about it like that. But think about it as an institution. When that institution is in your head, if Allah Azza wa Jal does not bless you with children, that institution will serve a certain purpose. If Allah give you children, that institution will serve another purpose, right? If you are rich, that institution will function in a certain way. If you are poor, that institution will function in a certain way. If one gets sick, that institution will function in a certain way, because marriage is an institution. Marriage is not a service plan. If it is a service plan, when the husband, his wife ceases to give him what he wants to get rid of her, right? And if the wife, her husband is a service provider, if he does not give her what she wants or what she agrees with, she doesn't want him. Yes? Because marriage here is to fulfill purpose. I want service, certain service from that marriage. If it does not give me that service, means marriage is no good. But if marriage is an institution, it will function regardless of the situation. Sick or healthy, poor or rich, job or no job, education or no education, children or no children, all the affairs, marriage is a fulfilling its purpose, which is to worship Allah and have that unit that is dedicating to Allah Azza wa Jal. If that unit is not increasing, it plugs into the bigger community and give more value. Wadih? So even if they're a couple who does not have children, they are benefiting the larger usra, the larger family of the community. They plug in. And now I don't have children, I have more time I'm going to give to those who have children. You see? I have money, I'm going to give to those who don't have money. I am healthy, I'm going to give to those who do not have health. I'm educated, I'm going to give to those who do not have education. And so on and so forth. Family, institution. Masjid is an institution. Not building. Okay? Building is where this institution functions. If it is a small building, it still functions. It's a big building, functions. Have a full-time school, functions. Have 1,000 people, it functions. Have 10,000 people, still functions on that scale, and so on. We benefit that the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what time is Asha? We benefit that the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the most important, if it is not the most important foundation of establishing the Muslim community. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal talked about the asas. Kalimat al-asas, يعني foundation. When Allah mentioned the masjid, in Quran, you will always find it associated with one of few things. Number one, the masjid as the means by which you strengthen your relationship with Allah. وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ Masjid is for who? So whatever you do in the masjid, you know that who is on top of the masjid? Yes. So now you understand that anything happens to the masjid has to happen according to the way of Allah, in the name of Allah, for the sake of Allah. That is when masjid is mentioned in the Quran. What other thing that masjid is mentioned? Its foundation. لَمَسْجِدٌ أُسِّسَ عَلَى التَّقْوَى مِنْ أَوَّلِ يَوْمٍ أَحَقُّ أَنْ تَقُومَ فِيهِ You need to stand in that masjid that established on taqwa from the first day. So it talked about the foundation, the spiritual foundation of the masjid before the concrete foundation. What else when the masjid is mentioned? It's mentioned about what kind of people are in it. في بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع ويذكر فيها اسمه That Allah gave permission for it to be raised and His name to be mentioned in فيه في بيوت أذن الله أن ترفع ويذكر فيها اسمه يسبح له فيها بالغدو والأصال رجال لا تلهيهم تجارة In the day and in the night there are people, the quality of people who are there who are mentioning Allah, they are not distracted by the trade or the business. Selling and buying. They are not distracted. Huh? Allah did not say that they don't do. No, they do. But that does not distract them from the masjid. Subhanallah, look around you. It is the other way around. It is the other way around. Nothing distracting me from my business, even the dhikr of Allah. I only do it when I'm out of my work. So what is the original? What is the default? Tijara wa bay'ah. And what is the exception? The dhikr of Allah. And I will make sure that nothing distracts me from my degree, nothing distracts me from my business, nothing distracts me from my work. And when I'm done, inshallah, I'm going to come and pray. But how Allah Azza wa Jalla said in the Quran, لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع. And they have tijara, they have bay', but it does not distract them from the ذكر of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the salah وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة آية عجيبة دي خلي بالكم This آية is a very amazing آية يعني they are living their life but their life is not distracting them from the ذكر of Allah and إقام الصلاة and إيتاء الزكاة It is not like if I have time I'm going to give huh? No I have to give salah and the zakah and I have to accommodate my life according to that So always when the masjid is mentioned in that context. Your relationship with Allah, what quality of the people who are in there, right? The foundation of the masjid is what? So whenever you find masjid, you'll find that discussing like that. Not how big, not how tall is the minaret, not how clean is the carpet, not how much light. This is beside the point. Yeah. All of these things to fulfill the goal. If we focus on those things, we lose the goal. They are important, but not the main. Also, the masjid is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in jama'ah. That's important, right? Each one of us can pray at home. Sahih? And actually it's more comfortable physically. Yeah. You don't have to change. You don't have to do all these things. Just pray and do about your life, whatever you are, in your pajamas or whatever. More convenient, more comfortable. But that's not the point. The point is not to just get over with the salah comfortably. Do you think? No. Salah is not only finishing the ruku' and the sujood. That's why we have wudu before it. Okay? That's why you walk and with every step you have reward. That's why you have to make the effort and come in the masjid and be challenged with other people who actually disagree with you. And you got to stand in the line together, and you're going to hold yourself, and you're going to follow that guy. That's the point of coming to the masjid. Actually, this is the point. Think about it, and you will find that it's actually changing your life. That's why the community is not functioning properly, because they are overlooking the importance of lining up in the jama'ah daily. Lining up in the jama'ah daily, it breaks your arrogance, it breaks your ego, it makes a different person from you, it makes a member of a jama'ah, not an individual, not a selfish guy. It does that. Coming to the masjid does that. That's why I tell people, it doesn't matter how busy you are, at least once in the United States, at least once a day, make an effort and make a point to come and attend one jama'ah per day. At least. Do it. You say, I'm going to pray Isha every night in the masjid. I'm going to pray Fajr every night in the masjid. Whatever salah that works for you. And then make this your minimum. Doesn't matter, even if you're crawling, man, just do it. Do it, and you'll see the taste of it over a year time or 2 years time. But you have to be continuous, and shaitan will fight you like crazy. I'm telling you. If you do it, then you will build on it. In the weekend, I'm going to come 2-3 times. Right? And I'm going to do this, and I'm going to attend another lecture. And you'll find yourself building up the pace. Building up the pace. I remember when I started the exercise routine, I see people on the stair step. You know, stair steps. And they are there like standing there for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, half hour. And sweating and number one. I said, Wallahi, that must be a very good exercise, you know. I'm in the treadmill on the lowest incline and, you know, thinking I'm exercising, right? Then, you know, I try the stair steps, Wallahi, 30 seconds. And I'm like this. Then, you know, I said, wow, these people... And then I asked someone, how we do all of this? He said, pace, build up. Tells you how many floors, right? So 2 floors. And once you become comfortable, you will find yourself adding 2 more floors. And before you know it, you are 30 floor, 40 floor, 50 floor, until you actually lose count. And you go by time, right? And then after that, it becomes like a regular part of your life. So everybody looking at you thinking you just started this today. But it's a build-up. Same thing for the masjid and salah. It's very hard. That's why Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةً إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ Right? So salah is heavy. استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة. Seek help in sabr and salah, and it is hard. Allah did not say it's going to be easy. So salah is hard. Salah in jama'ah is harder. Salah in jama'ah in the masjid is harder. Salah in the masjid regularly is even harder. Right? Maintaining that for a longer time is harder and harder. You're getting it, right? But you're going to build somewhere. You're going to start somewhere. In the masjid was a university. Masjid of Rasulullah, he teaches. So advanced people who are sitting there, people who come and go, young, old. So he has like K-12 plan in the Masjid of Rasulullah. The older teach the younger, the men and the women, and everybody was in the Masjid of Rasulullah. A center for counseling and problem solution. An army headquarters. Was even a hospital. When people get injured in war or something like that, they get treated in the masjid. They take a side of the masjid, they make a tent or something, and the ladies, they nurse. They give the nursing, you know, like they are the nurses. Give the water and heal the wounds and patch it and wrap it and all of that. In the masjid of Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even when somebody comes, delegations, they come and the Rasulullah meet them. So we talk about interfaith, about our neighbors, about people. Yeah, this is a sunnah. Invite people to come know about Islam. You come inside the masjid, no problem. Rasulullah allowed them to come in the masjid and even pray their prayers. Some of the Sahaba said, leave them, finish. They faced the east and prayed their own prayers in the masjid of Rasulullah, with the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then he showed them Islam and they did not accept it, they left. Yes? At the time of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So sometimes we need to get educated, right? We need to learn and get educated and follow the sunnah. Masjid is the community. Community is the masjid. And it functions in all affairs, subhanAllah. But when we think about it as a service center, oh, salah only. So look, someone said, how come, Sheikh, there are sisters without hijab, we allow them to enter the masjid? Said, well, and the masjid is only for people who are ready, yani, people who are good, and hijab and beard and everything. But what about the sinners? What about the people who are wrong? What are people, the one who are lost? At least they found the direction of the masjid. Let them come in, we'll talk about what they do. We're not endorsing, we're not approving. Yani when somebody enter and I let them enter, does not mean I agree with what they do. Mushrikeen, we allow them to enter. So Muslimin, yani, who are disobedient, we don't allow them to enter. Ajeeb Allah hadha al-amr. Yes, it's how you handle it. That should be our concern. How it is handled. How it is handled. That is what we should be concerned about. What we do after they enter. It's not entering or not. It is how we handle it. How we receive. That's education, right? That's education. When a delegation from non-Muslim come to the masjid, who talks? Who present? Who discusses? Not anybody at any time. كل واحد يعني ما شاء الله on his own. On his own. One sheikh one time was saying a true story that a brother became a Muslim, came to the masjid, okay, announced shahada, oh takbir, everything, everybody hugs him, broke his yani, hug, but that's not the idea. Then after that he was grabbed by a couple of brothers. What is your Muslim name now? You gotta choose Muslim name, man. Do I have to? Yes. Okay. Yal, Muhammad. Alright. Okay, then he goes, before he leaves the masjid, he's grabbed by other people. Here, wear this. Right? You cannot pray without it. You have to put it in your head. Do I have to? Yeah. Okay, he put it in his head. Then he's grabbed by some other people. So, no. This is the kafir clothes, you have to wear them. True, huh? This is not. So everybody, mashallah, volunteering to help the brother. To the point that someone said you have to put kuhl in your head, in your, you know, surma. So what's they call it? Surma? Yeah, kuhl. So some brothers put kuhl. And then they emphasized, by next week, you have to have a beard, man, I'm telling you. He said, okay, all right, so next week he have that. Then, you know, a few weeks later, he went to visit his parents. He knocks on the door. They look. They see what? They see someone having a beard and the long things. They call 911. That's a true story. It's not a joke, yeah. And then, subhanAllah, this man meets a scholar later on. And I ask him about this, you know, I am a new Muslim for 2 months now and I'm doing this. He said, why? Why you change your name? Why you have to do all of this? Take it easy, man. Did you learn how to pray? Oh, I'm learning. See, and all of this, look, before you even know how to do salah, what is this? Now, what is the point I'm trying to get at? Not everybody can do everything. So as a masjid, as a community, as a jama'ah, we should be organized. We hear committee this, committee that. That's a good thing, by the way, if it is done right. There is a committee to welcome newcomers. Like when a new Muslim, come and said, you know, now I am living around you here in Champion. Or now I am planning to come here to Masjid Champion, Masjid Salam. I'm planning, I got a job here and I'm going to do that. There should be certain group, families of brothers and sisters who invite this family, if it's a family, or invite this man, huh, and walk him through
Yes? So this masjid is having this activity, how many children you have, we have this school, you know, your wife will do this, you know, assign somebody to go with that. And you Muslim, assign somebody to teach them the salah, the wudu, for the first month, someone. If it's not one person, then we have 5-6 brothers. If it's a sister, 5-6 sisters, right? So the wudu and the salah of today, it is on that person. And the next time, like that. And then they take them to buy the clothes. Then they show them the grocery store. And that's how you do. And then, you know, that's how we eat. That's what we do. That's how they learn with the jama'ah. Right? To become a Muslim, integrated Muslim. And then 1 to 2 years, that same person will help you with the new ones, better than you actually, because they went through the experience. Right? And that's how our deen works. But not everybody overzealous and they volunteer their opinion. When some people want to know about Islam, everybody become an expert, mashallah. Want to talk to them. And some new person, everybody volunteer to tell them the wrong and the right and everything of the community. Overwhelm them. They might actually go away. Doesn't work like that. Rasulullah ﷺ have assignments for the Sahaba. I told you last time, Abdullah ibn Zayd saw the dream of the Adhan. But Rasulullah said, go teach it to Bilal because his voice is better than yours. Khalas. He is not saying, but I am the one, the credit is mine. I am. No, it doesn't work like that. You saw it, this is your honor. Allah reward you for it. But to execute this task, it has to be this one. This battle, Umar should lead it. But this battle, Usama should lead it. And this battle, Amr ibn al-As should lead it, even though he accepted Islam 6 months ago. The right person for the right task. That's what we learn from that stage of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam seerah. Now, again, the masjid was the source of authentic news, not the source of rumors. If you hear something in the community, you come for Salat al-Isha to know what is the true story. Not the other way around. Somebody come to the masjid and then go to the room. You know what? I heard people saying such and such. Who said? People talking about it. I don't know. So actually you did not know anything. And when you come to the masjid, you hear the rumors. It's supposed to be the other way around. You come to the masjid to know the real story of things. You have problems, you come for the masjid for solution. It is not like you manage your life okay and come to the masjid, problems. You don't have any news, you come to the masjid, wrong news. You are having one idea, you come to the masjid, you become confused. What kind of masjid is that? It's supposed to be the other way around. I am confused, I come from masjid, and now I'm clear. I have a problem, I come to the masjid, now I'm calm. I have issues at home, I come to the masjid, alhamdulillah, the issue is solved. I find the nasiha, I find the community, I find the happiness, and I go back. Masjid should be like that. Also, from that stage, we learn from Rasulullah ﷺ how he does tarbiyah with role modeling. You know, role modeling is the best way actually of educating people through action. Role modeling is by action. The two most serious aspects of education is role modeling and the hidden curriculum. That's in the theory of education, right? There is something called unintended or hidden curriculum. Sometimes hidden curriculum is intended, sometimes it's not intended, based on who does the curriculum. Right? I'm teaching you this class here, Seerah. What is the curriculum? The Seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We say this happened, right? That's called the formal curriculum. This book, you ask me, I say this book, page number this, like that, right? We are talking about Hijrah, and now we are talking about the establishment of the Muslim community. Yes? So that's what? The formal direct curriculum. What is the informal or the indirect curriculum? That you learn the morals, you learn a lesson. We should do that, which I am saying as well. So this is the main curriculum, but I comment here and there, and I say how our masjid should function. But what is the hidden curriculum? The core values. The hidden curriculum is everything I did not say, but you're going to get. That's called what? Hidden curriculum. the hidden curriculum and the role model. Sometimes role modeling is a hidden curriculum. You don't say anything, but you do something. So if someone comes now and he says Salaam Alaikum, and I look at him, Alaikum Salaam Ratullah. Okay? And then another person comes and says Salaam Alaikum, Alaikum Salaam. Okay? And the third person comes and says, Wa Alaikum Salaam wa Rahmatullah. And then I continue my class. What did you get? There is some difference. Then you have to analyze now, right? And you're going to keep watching me, how I'm dealing with these three people. Oh, there is something. Oh, this guy is, oh, this guy is that. That is what role modeling and hidden curriculum does to you. Okay? That's why. Somebody said, give example of what our kids are learning. I said, okay, I'll give you example. Because I did education, a master's in education, so I know. I said, okay, you have in the book about children, teaching children, so you find a picture of a boy and a girl, right? Or two boys playing in the playground, or two girls playing in the playground, or a group of girls and boys playing in the playground. That lesson is talking about sharing. It's talking about what? Sharing. And you see them, they have sandwiches or something, and they're cutting and giving each other. So you got the curriculum, right? What is the hidden curriculum here? How the kids are dressed. Right? So if it's teenagers, that is a picture of what a teenager should look like. So that's what they're getting without a word. You get the point now, right? So you see the advertisement and you're seeing movies, teenagers seeing movies and seeing movies and seeing movies and seeing people dressed. They are not talking about anything. They are not saying anything. Actually, the plot is completely different. The story is different completely. So you as an adult don't pay attention. You're just looking and you said, oh, this is very clean movie. It is a very clean movie, right? Has nothing, no kissing, no hugging, nothing like that, right? But the kid is learning one thing. That is how a teen should talk. That's how a teen should walk. That's how a teen should behave. That's how he's dealing with his parents. That is the hidden curriculum, not the story. You understand the danger of hidden curriculum? And that is what we do in the masjid, hidden curriculum, always negative. Kids come to the masjid, find the adults fighting. Find somebody raising the voice. How my father is looking at the imam, and how my imam is looking at my father. How my mother is sitting, how the brothers are doing. When we have a carnival, what happens? Right? This is coming to the head of the kids all the time, all the time, all the time. And you think you're doing the greatest thing in the world, which you are, okay? But there is a hidden message delivered. All the time, hidden message delivered. While in the other side, another hidden message delivered completely opposite. Wrong has been done, but the kids know it is wrong. You are telling them haram, 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 haram. They sing haram, 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 haram. But they sing how soft, how nice these guys are. And here's halal, halal, halal. Good, good, good. Sunnah, sunnah, sunnah. But how rough these people are. What's going to happen now? Now you get the idea, right? It's very dangerous, isn't it? So it doesn't matter what you do on the outside. How you believe. How much you love being here. That little 2-3 year old, believe me, he gets that feeling. He does not get the outer part. They are innocent. Sponge. How many times when you are irritated at home, you find your kids are hovering around you? Yeah? When your mood is not good. Nothing changes outside, but the kids feeling your attention is not there. That's why they keep saying, Baba, Mama, like that, you know, coming, jumping over you and all of that. Why? Because your mood is not there. Sorry? Your mood is not there. You're tired, you're exhausted, your finances, your problems, you are sitting there and thinking, they are seeing beyond you. They are seeing inside of you. That's not my dad who is coming jolly and happy and nice and all of that, right? So there is something. So they come onto your attention. Like that. That's your hidden curriculum working. So pay attention to. That's why always Rasulullah said, Taqwa ha huna, taqwa ha huna, taqwa here, heart. Allah looks to your heart, does not look outside. That's why we said salah tanha al fahsha wal munkar. See how the deen makes sense now, right? All of that. So it's not the routine outside. It is the hidden curriculum. It is the hidden curriculum. It teaches you things that you sometimes you don't need. And sometimes it teaches you things that you need in a hidden way. And sometimes advertisement in the TV make something does not have any necessity huge for you to think it's very important. You want me to give you an example? Okay. Couple of days ago, I watched an advertisement about Charmin. You know Charmin toilet papers? I'm sorry to use that example. Yani. But how they want to convince you to buy it? They are bringing a Charmin piece and a normal piece. And they put bunch of coins, you know bunch of coins in here and bunch of coins in here. Right? So what happens? They say Charmin can take this many coins and it does not break. But once you put 2-3 coins here, it breaks. What you say as a customer now? Tell me what you say as a customer now. Which one is better? Why? For the purpose that Charmin does, do you need all this many coins? Do you need this strong yani? Do you need it to be that strong? No. You know, this one, 2 coins made a hole. All right, if 3 coins, 4 coins is enough. Because what is going to do, yani? I'm not going to carry coins in it. It is to serve a different purpose altogether. You understand me? This toilet paper is to serve a different purpose altogether. Okay? So coins has nothing to do with this. All right? But they make you think that this is important. And that's how you value things. So it is not about the function of it. It is how it looks, how is this. Like a guy walk in the Apple store and say, give me your most expensive computer. It has everything in it. Because this is the aqeedah now that I don't want anything to be needed. But what, ya Habib, you're going to use the computer for? Just to browse the internet and maybe I can read books. Okay, buy a Kindle for $100. And you can download all the books you want. La, I want an Apple Mac. Why? Oh, okay. So you think like that. So from the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we learn what we need. We learn the qualification, you know, it should be given to a qualified. We learn how to establish standards. We learn how to have core values. And different situations does not matter. Once you have core values, you will function according. So the Muslim adapts to the environment and function with those core values. But when you focus on the salah only as a routine, on the siyam only as a routine, on the beard only as a routine, on this, on that, then you lose the core values. And then you have a problem. Because when anybody prevents you from this, you kind of stall over there. But a Muslim always function when they have the core values. And that's what Rasulullah taught us. Abu Huraira, when he focused, now this is the time for education and I need to be exposed to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So what should I do? I should stay here. Now Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. Now I need to distribute this education. So I go. Now someone trusts me with leadership. I will become a leader. So he will function as a student, as a teacher, as a leader. Same Abu Huraira. Okay? Same Abu Bakr, who was the sahib of Rasulullah, who was supporter of Rasulullah, who is khalifa of Rasulullah. Same Umar, who is the supporter of Rasulullah, who is the supporter of Abu Bakr, and now he is the Amir al-Mu'mineen. Same Uthman, same Ali, same Aisha, same Khadija, same everyone, having same core values, and they function wherever they are put. Subhanallah, they function. And you see that, I finish with it, you see that in the very successful business people. There are people whose specialty is to save failing businesses. So what they come in, they don't do anything new. They don't do anything. They don't bring anything new, yeah. You have the capital, you have your restaurant, you have your team. Okay, let me change and shuffle things around. You know, the way you deal is not like that. This table has to be here, and the efficiency line, and how this starts, and how this finishes, they see things different, right? And once the person does that, the business picks up like crazy. They go to a completely different line of business. This is the food business, they go here, so internal design. And it has a problem. And again, he sees where is the problem. He tells me, business picks up like that. There are programs like this in the TV, right? These guys who come and save the businesses. Why? Because they have a core value. they have a value. You put them in any situation, they will solve it. There are some people who have the opposite, subhanAllah. Right? They are problem creators. You put them in a place, they create problem. You don't give them responsibility, they are good. So subhanAllah, we have to find that, and all of this we learn it from the seerah of Al-Habib Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we stop here inshallah and we continue next Thursday. Sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen.